We love them for everything that they do. And Father, we have prayed at this time for our many people that are throughout the world fighting for our freedom. And I pray, Father, that our people will come back to know you. And Father, help them in your prayers and your various problems throughout the world. We have our people everywhere, Father. And we have these terrible terrorist situations now that that we just don't know what to do. And it seems like there's no end. And Father, we thank you for for the privilege of thanking our government and praying for our government that they'll do the right thing at the right time to help us in this ungodly thing. And Father, we pray that that you will go with us and help us to keep on keeping on for us. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Boys and girls, y'all can kill those monitors on the stage if you haven't already. I was reminded when Dan made a statement about how big Texas is. And yesterday we kind of had a surprise visit at our house, our daughter's grandsons and our daughter's mother-in-law came to visit. And so they were there through the day, through dinner time, and that sort of thing. And she told me a little bit about her experience. She drove in from California. And so she's talking about the enormity of Texas. You make that statement. It really is something that unless you see the sign out there on the highway, it's what, 837 miles or something to El Paso? Until you've actually driven that, you know, and you think, there's no way that this could be any longer. And then you start driving across New Mexico and Arizona, and that's like, there's nothing forever. And so it's an interesting country in which we live. We have so many things that we can see, so many different kinds of experiences. And I would tell you, as a Christian, we're dealing with the same kind of thing in our experience, because generation after generation comes and passes by. And there's this pendulum of experience that's constantly swinging. For those of you not young, they don't know what a pendulum is. You know, clocks used to have a thing that would swing at the bottom and go one way and come back. Well, that's a pendulum. And so the Christianity has gone through a lot of focus times where people have focused on certain things. Now, the things that were true in that focus remain true even as the swing moved over to another focus. If it was true, it was always true. It continues to be true even if there's another focus at the time. We go back and forth in that. And each generation of Christians sometimes revisits some of the doctrines and things that we believe as Christians, and it captures their attention. And unfortunately, at times, for not just Southern Baptists, but for Christians in general, it doesn't become a place of understanding. It becomes a place of division. And it's really sad. Because no matter what you believe about election calling, chosen, predestined, foreknowledge, if you're standing up here and it's invitation time and a 12-year-old child comes up to you and says, I need Jesus, and you talk to them about being saved, how much do they know about election, calling, being chosen, about being predestined or foreknowledge? What do they know about that? But what happens in their life is that they become a born-again child of God by a work of God that certainly we may struggle at times to understand everything about. My alma mater seminary, Southwestern, is very devoted to Calvinism at this time. They spent a lot of money to make a video series, very interesting, very kind of graphic thing. The guy looks like he's speaking to you from caverns and all kinds of things. And if you want to hear a viewpoint of Calvinism, the work of John Calvin and others during his time period many centuries ago, they'll be more than happy to allow you. YouTube or something like that, probably. I think they're there, maybe. And you can get all of that information in depth. But this is something that is going to be, from the perspective as God has worked in my life in this situation, to help you see that sometimes, since God's thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts and His ways are higher than our ways, that we struggle to grab onto something that has a paradoxical nature. Can it be one and the other, or both simultaneously? You say, well, that just can't be true. I say, okay, then it cannot be true that God is one and also three. It can't be true, because you just told me there is not a place for paradoxical beliefs in the Christian faith. Well, but wait, you might say, but God revealed the fact to us that He is one God. There's only one God. And yet He reveals Himself as three distinct persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so I don't get that in terms of being able to wrap my little pea brain around it. I don't have to. God is not asking my permission. He is telling me who He is. Amen. And so the Muslim world may never accept the idea until they're standing face to face on the great white throne judgment and seeing for themselves that God is one and yet three. Amen. And that they had to have it solidly fixed one way or the other in their human mind, even though God had revealed Himself differently. So we have to be careful today, because the things that we talk about here are not going to make anyone more saved or less saved if, in fact, they are a born-again follower of Christ. When you talk about these kinds of things, more often than not, you're going to hear in Calvinism that there are five major points. You've got your little notes page. It's on the other side of the card that says what all the page numbers are, or what we're saying and all that. If you want to write this down, it's not going to be up here. The letters T-U-L-I-P. You mean tulip? Yeah. The word tulip is simply a way that they've tried to explain some of the key factors. And the T stands for total depravity. In other words, man is sin. Jesus said, there's no one good. How many? Not even one. That we all are affected by sin to the point that we are not able to find our way to God. We're in total darkness. We're dead in trespasses and sins. We are totally depraved. It's a total inability, because of the fall of man into sin, to be able to do anything to save themselves. Another one of the points to you is unconditional election. And that is the idea that God is choosing and saving people in eternity past, before they are born, and that it's not based on any virtue or merit or faith on the part of these people. And the idea is that simply God chooses who's going to be saved. Limited atonement is the L. Particular redemption is sometimes what it says. And in this view, God has brought salvation to a specific group of people. So Jesus died on the cross, but He died for the sins of the people who He was going to save. Now, it might have been something that he would love for everybody else to have been saved. Whosoever will might be saved. This is our paradox. Now we're going to struggle right here. But the idea is that he's only saving those, even in his work of atonement, that would be the ones he would choose to save. The I stands for irresistible grace. In other words, you could not avoid salvation. You can't run from it. You can't get away from it. If God is going to save you, he's going to save you. You may think that you're turning away from God, that you're resisting, but ultimately, if he has elected you to salvation, you're going to be saved. The last is the perseverance of the saints. That people who are really born again followers of Christ will persevere to the end. They will prove that they in fact belong to God because he has saved them, whether they really wanted him to or not, and they're going to stick with it to the end. Now I'm going to tell you, and without telling you which ones, that although I understand these doctrinal teachings, I am not a pure five-point Calvinist. Not that you would be surprised, because I think some of you might tell me that you're a pure five-point Calvinist, that you believe in those things, and then I would catch you singing some hymn or some song that would let me know that you were saying that with your brain, but you weren't that way in your heart. You'd be walking down the hall, whosoever will, whosoever. And I'm like, limited atonement. Right? So we get these songs, we get these things, and they betray us as to often what our beliefs are. Let's look at some scripture. You want to do that? That's what's going to matter. The Word of God and the presence of the Holy Spirit here today. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside with angels, let's go on down, who are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God. Now, if you're a five-point Calvinist, you would say that if people are being saved based on the fact God had to foreknow, then there is a prerequisite for him saving them, and that is to wait on his foreknowledge of their decision. The problem is that God is timeless. He doesn't exist in time. What he experiences, the end from the beginning from the end, he knows all of the things, all of the time. He didn't have to wait on anything. He simply knows. And so if what you're saying here is that they are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God, to what? To obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. To obey Jesus Christ and to be sprinkled with his blood. Sprinkled with his blood is salvation. To obey Jesus Christ, we're going to see in a verse in a little while, means simply that he says to the people, they say, what works must we do to work the works of God? Jesus says, believe in him who he has sent. Believe in me, is what he's saying. So, I look at this verse and I see foreknowledge not as a precondition that God had to meet, waiting to see whether or not I was going to be saved. But what I see is that God knows and he has chosen, called, predestined certain things with these people that we're going to respond.
Amen.
Now, it says here to obey Jesus Christ and to be sprinkled with his blood. Notice it says, chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of the Spirit. The Spirit of God is in the process not only of bringing justification to us, that spark in which we're saved, that moment of justification, but this work of carrying us through to be fully like Christ, it's something that God is already able to see complete. He knows what you look like. He knows what I look like. When I am in a glorified body and I look and act like Jesus, he's already there. That's why he doesn't give up on you. If you're a born again child of God, he's not going to give up. He knows how you already turn out. Sometimes we become so fearful when we struggle God knows that we're going to struggle. The idea is, do we simply have no concern that we sin? And the scripture warns us if that's the case, then there's a good chance we're not really born again. Notice in Romans 11, verses 1 and 2. I say then, God has not rejected his people. This is the discussion about whether or not Israel has been thrown away. May it never be. For I too am an Israelite, descendant of Abraham, tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he predestined, whom he elected. No, whom he foreknew. And so what I'm trying to do is not knock the blocks out of Calvinism. Folks, your pastor is never going to be sharp enough to do that. Never. I'm not going to get in the blocks with John Calvin. I'm not going to get side by side with Charles Spurgeon and go into that and try to give you an argument that says, see, they're wrong. What I'm simply going to do today is to say, we look at the scripture and sometimes we find that there's a balance there that God is at work doing. And in the process, we who are born again don't have to figure it out, but we walk in the care, in the assurance, in the direction, in the protection, in the provision of God. And he's revealed all this concern, protection, provision, and all of these things clearly for us in his word. Look at Romans 8, starting in verse 28. You know all this first part, this awesome promise that we have that even the crummy things of life, God's going to reach into and bring good things from. But it says, to those who are called according to his purpose, to those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom he predestined, he also called. These whom he called, he justified. These whom he justified, he also glorified. So you go back to the beginning of the whole phrase, and it started with what? Did it start with calling? Did it start with justification? Did it start with glorification?